All right, good to be back tonight. I want to thank the Lord for letting us come. And we just praise the Lord. We got very a lot of people sick tonight, and we got a big old hole in our church. But like Lord said, it only takes a few. And the Bible says, where two or three are gathered together in my name, Jesus said, I'll be in the midst. And so we got more than three. We got four. No, we got a little more than four. But we got a lot of sickness tonight. I tell you, Leon and Liz has got the flu. Rosie was hurting all over. My sister Judy is sick. And I want you to remember her in prayer. And then Lisa, keep praying for her. She's doing good with her foot. And keep praying for Joe and Sonia and Roger and Kathy and James. And keep praying for Linda's brother there, that God will touch him, Frank. And I know there's more trying to remember who all we've been texting with today. So let's just keep praying for all the sick and needed in our church, and God will touch and help. Then we got folks out that are sick. Then we got folks out that we don't know. We hope they're doing all right, but we just don't know. But do pray much for them. Let's remember where death has come. There's three families, bereaved families, just that Wallace's. And I know there's others today. Pray for our nation. And I tell you what, I don't want to get into this. I despise people that that put themselves better than me. If I do a crime, I get charged with a crime. Don't you? I there's only one judge that can free me from all my sin, and that's Jesus Christ. And so I do pray the Lord will touch and help us. Pray for Israel. And pray that the Lord will touch. We're seeing so much stuff being revealed to us today that we've been watering in it a long time. We just didn't know it, because when you water in it, you begin to smell like it. But we need to pray for them. Sonia had the kidney transplant. She's doing well, and was thought she might get to come home today, right straight out of ICU. But she started running a fever, so it'll be tomorrow before they let her come. But she's doing extremely well with the kidney, and we just give God praise for that. And who else am I leaving out? Anybody? All on our church page. Let's remember them. Y'all. Yeah. Who? Adriana. Didn't I say her?
You may have. I
know. Amen. Y'all look as dumbfounded as I do here tonight. Come on, tell me something. All right.
I pray that Chris Russell gets good results. He had that biopsy Monday.
Amen.
I pray that he would get good results.
Now, you can tell me that it's either Coates' brother or his wife's brother.
It's Linda's
brother. Okay, and then he's in bad shape, right? So they're going to Texas.
Yeah, yeah. His brother.
Who is that?
Greg Coombs is.
They go with it. Yeah,
and we know him. They know.
Yeah, he's no Greg. Yeah.
Well, let's pray for them. Pray the Lord will touch there. All right. Anyone else? Anybody? All right. Let's read unspoken prayer request. Just lift your hand. All right. Anybody in here cold? You just came in, didn't you? Joanne would have raised her hand. All right, let's go to the Lord in prayer. And come on in, Chase. I guess we'll give you a minute to get in here before we have prayer. And we appreciate y'all coming, and appreciate the Lord letting us come tonight. Amen. All right. Wayne, would you ask the blessing, please?
Heavenly Father, we come to you just as long as we don't have it. Thank you for this day, and thank you for the many blessings.
Yes, God.
Dear Lord, all the prayer requests, not only none of them. And open up our hearts to Brother Joseph preaching tonight to remember our nation.
Yes,
we
Lord.
Ask this in your wonderful, sweet name. Amen.
Amen. I'm going to try 338. I may have to change chords a dozen times. 338. Before I get started on it, I don't know. Might not even do it.
Savior, who has won Chris kind and true. He's the rock of your salvation. There's honey in the rock for you. Oh, there's honey in the rock, my brother. There's honey in the rock for you. Take your sin to the blood to cover. There's honey in the rock for you. Have you tasted that the Lord is gracious? Do you walk in the way that's new? Have you drunk from the living fountain? There's honey in the rock for you. There's honey in the rock, my brother. There's honey in the rock for you. Leave your sin for the blood to cover. There's honey in the rock for you. One last one. Then go out to the streets and byways. Preach the word to many are few. Say to every fallen brother, there's honey in the rock for you. Oh, there's honey in the rock, my brother. There's honey in the rock for you. Leave your sin for the blood to cover. There's honey in the rock for you. Leave your sin for the blood to cover. There's honey in the rock for you.
Hey, amen. I like that old song. Still the wrong chord, but I like that old song. Amen. How about y'all? Y'all glad to be in church? Give a great big amen.
Amen.
My cousin Connie will be talking to a doctor, a surgeon there. I believe it's on the 16th. You can correct me if I'm wrong, Connie, but we want to keep praying for her and pray the Lord continue to touch and bless and help in this need. All right. I guess if I called on Chasey, it's too cold, or you lost your voice on the way down here. There ain't enough here for you to sing.
Yeah, and all above.
All above. All right. If I called on Donna, she said, "Well, if Chase ain't gonna sing, I ain't neither." Are you volunteering, Lord?
I think he was. He opened his mouth.
He opens his mouth a lot of times and nothing comes out. Amen.
He's always putting my foot in my mouth.
Yeah. Sorry. Yeah. You know what he's doing, Chase, when he's opening his mouth and nothing coming out? He's practicing to be a politician. All right. Come on, Wayne, start us off. And then we'll just move right on around the mic. And if y'all going to sing together, all right, Wayne, well, y'all go ahead and sing. And we'll just get everything to going, all right? Amen. I'm glad it's given us a way of getting the church out. We don't know how many people is going to be watching and praying. Wednesday night's been reaching up somewhere around 500 people. Isn't that amazing? So that's not boosted. That's just people following it that this is able to get us, that knows about it. So let's give the Lord praise for that. All right. Yes, it's about time you do that.
If I don't start barking for thee, I'll just bark back.
Right. See?
Dear Lord, as I come to you this evening, thank you.
Like that song, hey, man.
We gotta get Kenny teed up for tomorrow night.
She likes doing this song too.
What was that she said?
What's that?
About having every home. We'll pass that along to Dollar General and see what they think about that.
Oh, yeah.
Every home should have a Wayne and a Mikey hanging on the wall. What do you think about that, David?
I'd like to think there'd be more napkins and Kleenexes sold because there'd be a whole lot of crying going on.
Amen to that.
With a Mikey and a Wayne on the wall, there'd never be a mirror in the house, I guarantee you.
Yeah, there wouldn't be a need for one. There'd be nobody living there.
All right, that'd probably make the paint roll off.
Yeah, said that once or twice. Take my hand, precious Lord. Quit my way.
Is almost gone.
with y'all?
Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord.
E flat, I think. We'll see. I remember the words.
In lowly cattle stable in Bethlehem, there were signs of new destruction on the mighty span. In the hearts of all lost, cast a shadow of the cross, and that baby.
We may have to stop and change it. I'm glad to be in the Lord's house, ain't y'all?
Amen.
Amen. I'm glad we can come and still smile. That the world has took a lot away from us, but it ain't took away our smile. It ain't took away our love one for another, has it? Amen. It ain't changed a thing. We can still come down here and worship God and have joy in doing it. Amen. And it goes beyond fun. Amen. It's joy, and I praise the Lord for that today. If Jesus comes tomorrow, just spend some time with Him. Will you answer all His questions? Our life to life, the truth. Would you welcome Him with open arms, or even let Him in? If Jesus comes to my room again, if Jesus calls your name, could you? And your worldly good and turn and walk away. Would it take a month or Sunday just to tell Him of your sin? If Jesus comes to my door, what then? Mike's a flat man, you know. Most of the time he's A flat, right, Mike? A flat. Lord's a silent man. Lord has to be silent because he's going with Nancy and he can't get a word in edgewise, right? Is that right? See, he can't even say amen, just shake his head. All right.
Said the night went to little light. Do you see what I see? Way up in the sky, little lamb. Do you see what I see? A star. Goodness of mine.
got a song. We'll get situated here just a little bit. Don't want to forget to make the announcement also again that we'll be starting church at 10:30. All of our followers that's always getting us on the church page, Sunday morning we'll be starting at 10:30. And going to have a gathering after church. And we're looking forward to that time of fellowship. We're hoping all of our sick people are able to get to be back with us. And amen. And we're gonna have Chase wings, and Chase legs, and Chase all that. Somebody said, Chase got it? He's the chicken man. Amen. Amen. So we do praise the Lord for that. Amen. We said something about chicken today, and Jennifer, the girl helps us, said, who don't like chicken, you know? But I said, well, it can't be a Baptist, but there are Baptists that don't like chicken, amen. Amen. They just don't eat at my house. Right, Wayne. He don't like to eat chicken, but he loves them eggs, don't you, Wayne?
Amen.
Amen.
All right. I like them boneless. Boneless chicken.
You like boneless chicken?
Yeah, that's boneless chicken. Yeah, that's
space stuff. Oh God! Oh God! Did you know? Did you know they couldn't be a boneless chicken if there wasn't a chicken with a bone in him to start with? I don't understand him. Bless his poor old Pete Picker heart. All right. How'd we get off on chicken? I did it, didn't I? All right. God help me. All right, Joseph, come on.
It's kind of like people that try to argue, and I've had this discussion with many people. Because I always think, which came first, the chicken or the egg? The Lord's created the creatures. That's what the Bible says. The creature had to be there for the egg. What would be the purpose in him making an egg for it to have to crack itself and hatch? And I said, you got to have male and female before you have an egg.
He wanted a mold for Mike's egg.
Yeah. But anyway, we're going to be in Isaiah. I know I go to Isaiah a lot, and I go to Psalms a lot. And in my messages, it's where the Lord leads me. Isaiah is one of my favorite books. I can't tell you how many times I read through it. I'll get to the end of it and I'll say, well, we can go on to the next book. Oh, let's go through it again. So you know, because there's always something else that I miss. And y'all, it'll be Isaiah 37. And we'll be starting in verse 8, going through verse 20. I know that's a lot. Y'all bear with me. But before we read anything, I want us to go to the Lord in prayer and pray what the Lord has for each and every one of us that we'll get it, all right? Lord, we come before you as humble as we know how. So thankful, God, for this opportunity to be in your house. Thankful for this opportunity to stand. Thankful that you have allowed us to assemble together. The devil tries so much every week to try to make it where we can't come. But God, our victory is in you and our joy is in you. And we're thankful that you have allowed us to assemble together. I ask that you would touch those that couldn't be here, Lord, because of sickness and things going on. But I pray that you would deal with the ones that just wouldn't be here, that they'd wake up and realize that we shouldn't be forsaking the assembling of ourselves together, but we should be seeking to honor you. Lord, as the message is brought forth, Lord, however long or short it is, whatever you're giving this evening, Lord, I pray that it would touch every heart personally. And that they would search their hearts and draw to that they might give whatever might be between them and you out and just give everything to you. Lord, you are our helper. You are our strength. You are our victory. On you we can depend. You are ever faithful. And we just want to give you the praise, honor, and glory here this evening in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Now, I probably ain't going to say these names exactly right. So y'all just bear with me. So Rabshakeh returned and found the king of Assyria warring against Libna, for he had heard that he was departed from Lachish. And he heard saying concerning Tekara, the king of Ethiopia, he has come forth to make war with thee. And when he heard it, he sent messengers to Hezekiah, saying, thus shall you speak to Hezekiah, the king of Judah, saying, let not thy God, in whom thou trustest, deceive thee, saying, Jerusalem shall not be given into the hand of the king of Syria. Behold, thou hast heard what the kings of Assyria have done to all thy lands,
By destroying them utterly, and shalt thou be delivered? Have the gods of the nations delivered them which my fathers have destroyed, as Gozan and Haran and Reseph, and the children of Eden which were in Telassar? Where is the king of Hamath, and the king of Arphad, and the king of the city of Seraphim, Hena and Iba, or it's probably Iba? And Hezekiah received the letter from the hand of the messengers, and he read it. And Hezekiah went up into the house of the Lord, and spread it before the Lord. And Hezekiah prayed unto the Lord, saying, O Lord of hosts, God of Israel, that dwelleth between the cherubims, thou art the God, even thou alone, of all the kingdoms of the earth. Thou hast made heaven and earth. Incline thine ear, O Lord, and hear. Open thine eyes, O Lord, and see, and hear all the words of Sennacherib, which he has sent to reproach the living God. Of a truth, Lord, the kings of Assyria have laid waste to all the nations and their countries, and have cast their gods into the fire, for they were no gods, but the work of men's hands, wood and stone. Therefore they have destroyed them. Now therefore, O Lord our God, save us from his hand, that all the kingdoms of the earth may know that thou art the Lord, even thou only. Y'all can be seated. You know, last week I was speaking to you, preaching to you about what do you need? And when it boils down, you know, the answer to that question, what you need more than anything in this life is food. Jesus Christ, more than anything that you're facing, any trial that's coming up, whatever it is, the help that you need is Jesus Christ, right? Amen. But the Lord began also speaking to me, because as a child of God, because we are His, and because we have Him, we have access to Him. You see, the king of Assyria had come against Hezekiah. This was the second time in this little span. And the first time Hezekiah went to the temple, and he sent the three into Isaiah to ask them to seek the Lord. And he went to the temple himself and was praying. And God sent a little relief and caused war to come upon this land that this guy left, that Rabshakeh left. But Rabshakeh said, don't think that God is winning this for you. Don't think that you've got no victory in him. We've destroyed all the rest of them. Shall we not do the same with him? I'm just summing it up what I've just read, right? And then Isaiah, when he sees this message that Rabshakeh had sent, he don't just lay down. He don't just go into hiding and say, well, I guess the enemy's going to win. Does he? Does he? No, but he goes into the house of the Lord, and he takes that letter that Rabshakeh had wrote him to discourage him, the scaring, the tearing down. He takes that letter and he lays it out before the Lord. And he begins to pray over it and about what Rabshakeh said. He said, I'm not going to give up this fight. We're not defeated yet. I'm going to give it into the hands of the Lord. And you know, there's an important lesson that we can learn from what Hezekiah was doing here. That we have a place that we can take our petitions. We have somebody that cares about what we're going through, whether it be something big, whether it be something small, whether it be something that we just think is insurpassable. I'm telling you that we have a God that defies all odds. We have a God that has victory in his hands, no matter what nobody else says.
Amen.
Y'all believe that? It ain't nothing for God to defeat our enemy. It ain't nothing for God to heal the sick. It ain't nothing for God to raise the dead. He is still able, and he is still God.
Amen.
Y'all believe that?
Amen.
If you look on towards the end of the chapter there, you find out what God did next. Well, you start finding it out in 21 as Isaiah sends a response. But God sends a trouble in the camp, an angel into the camp, and he kills 185,000 Assyrians. The angel does. Nobody else has to stand up and fight, but he kills 185,000 of them when they wake up, they're dead. So how horrible. Yes, it is, but it's a dangerous thing to denounce the power of Almighty God. It's a dangerous thing to come against his people. You know what the devil is scared of? He's scared of a Christian praying. Amen. He don't want to knock you down to your knees. He wants to knock you on your back. He wants to knock you on your face more than anything, because if you're on your face, you're not looking up.
Amen.
But he don't want to knock you to your knees, because he thinks that he knows that when a Christian gets knocked to his knees, then his Father's going to step in, because he's finally asking for that he needs.
Amen.
So often we carry our burdens and our strife and everything so long, and we try to handle them when God is sitting there saying, give it to me, son. Let me step in for you. I can do this. I've got this. Listen to me.
Amen.
Right?
Amen.
There's power in the name of the Lord. You know, sometimes, well, we don't get our answer the first time. Does that mean that God don't hear it? Come on. Just because you don't get your answer the first time you pray, does that mean that God don't hear it?
No.
Is he deaf? Is he asleep? He said he wasn't. His ear is not shortened that he cannot hear, he said. Right? How about the second time? How about if he don't answer the second time? Does that mean he don't hear it, or that he don't care? I know some people will say God answers every prayer. I believe God works on every prayer and answers. But what if you don't see the answer the second time? Does that mean that he don't care about you? What about the third time? Now come on, surely the third time. If God hadn't moved in the situation the third time, surely that means that he's just not going to help. That he's not going to touch at all, right? Right? What about the fifth time? The sixth time? The seventh time? And you still hadn't seen an answer. Does that mean that you need to stop praying? Does that mean that you just need to give up? Does that mean that you just need to sit down and say, well, I guess things are going to be how they're going to be. Is that what that means? It isn't, is it? In Sunday school, we was talking about Elijah. And he told Ahab, he said, after they had had this thing where they killed the prophets of Baal and the Spirit of God was moving, he told him, he said, get ready, it's going to rain. Get ready, it's going to rain. And Elijah went up, and he began to pray, and he took his servant with him, and he said, go out there and look, and tell me what you see. The first time the servant come back, what did he say? He didn't see a thing, did he? Now Elijah just prayed, and fire had come down from heaven, and consumed the altar and the sacrifice, and licked up all the water. God had moved in a mighty power. But here Elijah was, the first time he prayed. Servant didn't see a thing. What happened when he sent him out the second time? Still nothing. This man who had all this power with God, still something. Now, I'm not mocking Elijah. I love Elijah, reading about Elijah. I'm just getting to a point. Third time, what happened? How many times did it take that his servant went out before he saw something? It's the seventh time, wasn't it?
Mm-hmm.
And when he saw something, what did he see? Did he see that the sky at that point was just full of clouds? He saw a cloud about the size of the hand of a man's hand. And he told Ahab, he said, you better get to Jezreel, because there's an abundance of rain. And the Spirit of the Lord came upon Elijah, and he outrun Ahab in his chariot and beat him to the city. You know what happened? The sky began to grow dark, and the rain began to fall. Right? What would have happened if Elijah just gave up? He'd probably been put to death like many of the others, right? He wouldn't have seen God's hand move upon the situation. He would have not seen that answer. There would have been a lot of people that was hungry and starving, because the word of the Lord had come through Elijah saying, his hand shall not rain again until I pray for it to. Right? So if he hadn't prayed for it, it would have dried up and went away, right? Because God is faithful to his word. But Elijah didn't give up after the first few times, all the way to the seventh time. And he got his answer. You know, we talk a little bit about this, and there's different beliefs on this. When you look it up, you study on it, about what a repetitious prayer is. Some people want to sum it up and say it's a prayer that is learned that you say over and over. Or this, there's others people that when you look it up and you study on these scholars, they say what a repetitious prayer was is what the heathen would do in the satanic chants and worship. When they just sit there and they would, you know, just over and over, just keep saying the thing under their breath over and over. But what a repetitious prayer is not when you have a need and you keep praying for it until you see an answer. That's not a repetitious prayer. That is a prayer of faith, a prayer of trust, that you're believing that God is going to move and that you haven't gave up on Him. That you're still looking for it. Right? So often we give up on our prayers to God so quickly before we see the answer because we lose faith. Just be honest. You say, oh no, I believe God just ain't going to work in this. I have plenty. No, you've lost your faith. Because Jesus said, ask anything in my name and I'll do it. It's got to be according to His will. It can't be a lustful prayer. But when it's a need, He's going to take care of His children. Again, and it reiterates what we said last week. If you need something, you need it in Jesus. You can get it through Jesus if there's a need. He will make a way.
Amen.
Randy was telling me about, I can't remember who it was, if it was somebody in his family or somebody he used to work with, I can't remember, but they didn't have nothing. They was out of food. And all of a sudden, this lady showed up. I think it was Randy's grandmother is who I think it was. Showed up and brought a carload of food and everything else to the house just out of the blue. And he said, ma'am, we sure do appreciate this. Said, you can go in there and look in our cupboards and see that we don't have anything. And he said, the Lord told me that I would have something to eat by this evening. Of course, the lady's response to that, and it would have been like mine, she did what the Lord warned her to do. It may not have been his grandmother. I can't remember who it was, but if he'd wanted something to eat, he should have got his butt off the porch and went and tried to work to get something instead of sitting there and waiting. But have you ever done that? God wants you to do a good thing and you start judging what you've done before you leave. You don't know their circumstances. You don't know what's going on, right?
That's right.
Why can't we just do what God wants us to do and not complain and not doubt and just trust God? If God says do this, then do it. But you got to be careful and make sure that it is God directing you and not the devil. That's a whole other message for a whole other time. What I'm getting around to tonight is that you need to bring your petition to the Lord. You need to bring it to Him and give it to Him and trust Him to do something about it. Hezekiah told him, says, you alone are God. Sure, they cast all these other gods into the fire, but they wasn't God at all. But you are God, and you can do something about it. We need to start addressing God as our loving Father and say, we understand, God, that you alone are God.
Amen.
And that you alone can do something about it.
Amen.
Not me. Not my friends. But you, Lord. Right? Y'all believe that?
Amen.
How many of you's got burdens that you've been wrestling with?
Amen.
How many of you doubt God's ever going to move? Now come on, I ain't asking you to raise your hand, but I want you to answer that. How many of you doubt that God's ever going to move because you hadn't seen it happen yet? We're raised up in a society that says don't believe unless you see. Say that you can do anything and be anything. You can be a fairy tale preacher now with the crap that's going on this woke generation. If you want to go around and say that you're a cat, you can be a furry or whatever the new word for it is. Now they've got another word for it that I can't remember what it is.
Stupid.
It is. If you think that your workplace needs a litter box set outside while where you're going around working, they've got to do it. Y'all think I'm crazy, don't you? No, it's happened in Lafayette. The people there got so woke at one of these places, one of these meals, that from what I understand, they have had to set litter boxes out in these places because there's people that think that they're cats. That's not trusting in God. They say, you say that ain't got nothing about trusting God. Oh, yes, it does. Because you're saying that God didn't make you what you should be. You're saying that you was born a human, but you shouldn't have been a human. You should have been a dog, or you should have been a cat, or you should have been a monkey. Now, I can agree with something about the monkeys. I really think a lot of them should have been a horse's rear end. Because that's what they're acting like. Right? You want to see something happen about all this? You say, oh, you're preaching hate. I ain't preaching hate. I'm saying there's a mental problem with these people. There's a sin problem with these people. You want to know what's wrong with America? It's a sin problem. You want to know why all the trouble's going on right now? Because there's a sin problem. You want to know why all the people in Congress are scared and why all these people are fleeing all these countries worried about what's going to be revealed about them? Because there's a sin problem.
Amen.
You know what's wrong with you? It's a sin problem.
Amen.
Say, I'm saved. I ain't saying you ain't. But we're living in a sin-tossed world. And if you ain't praying and giving it to God the way you need to every single day, then you've got a sin problem.
Amen.
A sin problem. There's only one way out, folks. One way out. And that's through the blood of Jesus Christ. It don't matter who disagrees with that. You know, how about that about Miss Oprah? You know, y'all know about all that, about where she tried to get people to say Jesus ain't done away and she just don't believe that and all this. And she tries to make herself some kind of priestess of this garbage. And now she's getting in trouble. Y'all heard about that, ain't you? Mm-hmm. About this girls' school, really wasn't for girls' school, and what she was doing with them young ladies. She wasn't no righteous hero. This, like we've tried to tell you for years, she was a demon.
Amen.
And she won you hearts because she would give you money and give you prizes. People liked her because that she gave back to them to satisfy their lust. Hey, that's what it is. The ladies on The View, you know what they are? They're a bunch of atheistic dummies.
Amen.
Godless people trying to lead people straight to hell. You know, they had Bill Clinton on there the other day. I saw a news excerpt about what he said. He's up there spreading lies about this and that. And talking about how they had never done anything wrong, and they, you know, nothing was proven. Said they've done everything according to the law, and he just thinks he's as innocent as a young child. He ain't.
No.
Hillary ain't.
Amen.
You know what's wrong? They think their self is above God. But I'm here to tell you, God has a way of getting things revealed.
Amen.
God has a way of turning things around. God has a way of taking care of his people and letting no rest come to the wicked. Is that what the Bible says?
Amen.
There is no rest for the wicked. You know the difference between the righteous and the wicked? Between having Jesus in your heart. When I read it to you in Psalms where it says that he gives his beloved rest. God wants his beloved to have sleep. He wants them to have peace when you study and read. The devil don't want you to have rest. He wants you to be blinded. He wants you to be asleep, but he don't want you to have rest. God wants your burdens. He wants your hardships. He wants the things that stress you out, the things that worry you. The things that put you hunched over, where the devil is trying to forge chains and weights upon your shoulders that make you feel like you're staring at the ground all the time. Jesus wants those things. He wants you to give them to him. He wants to break those chains and bear them for you. But you have to bring your petition to the Lord. Just like I read last week, he already knows what you have need of before you ask. But you still need to ask. You know, I can pray for you all I want. But there comes a certain time that you're going to have to seek God yourself.
Amen.
I can believe all I want and God can do many things. But the true enemy in your life is never going to be defeated until you take hold of the handle of faith and believe too. You understand that? You know, when he sent the scribes and them before Isaiah, the inquire before God, God did work. But God did the big work when Hezekiah took that letter and cried out before God himself. and really sought the Lord. You want to see the big work done in your life? Then you need to do some praying. You need to do some trusting. You need to do some believing. And the Lord God Almighty. Y'all believe that?
Amen.
So, whatever petition you have, don't just wad it up and throw it in the garbage. Whatever complaint, whatever trouble, whatever it is that's confusing you, that's burdening you. You know, I talk to so many people and it's always about them. Always about them. Anybody deal with that? Maybe it's always about you. I don't know. Always about them. It don't matter what's going on. It's going to result to how miserable they are, how terrible what life is. You say, how many people you talk to that's about a bunch? You don't think that's of the devil? Huh? God gave us this life. We're supposed to love Him. And here we are saying how miserable it is to live in a world where we can love Him. Right? So, well, what about the pain and the suffering? But what about the other things? What other things? See, the devil's already blinded you. Right? The devil's already blinded you. What other things? Love. Real love. Godly love. Brotherly love. Church fellowship. Family, what God, salvation above all things. These things, why can we not ponder on them some? You will when you begin to truly bear your petition to the Lord. Am I saying that He's going to answer the first time? No, I'm not. But I believe God is faithful and that if you're persistent, He will be faithful to you. Amen? It's what the Bible teaches. When you study it, that's what the Bible teaches. Just hold on a little longer. Betty used to love that song. Hold on a little longer. Help is on the way. Just keep praying. Just keep praying.
Amen.
When Elijah went to the widow woman that was about to fix the last little bit of morsel of food for her and her son, she prayed to God. Do you think that she answered it in the way that, do you think God answered it in the way she prayed? Do you think that she expected a man of God to show up to her house? She was giving everything up. She was ready to die. And then there God was, ready to move. What if you got to the point where you were just ready to give up? Ready to give up, and you decided to just give up, and then the next thing, there God was ready to work. In the situation. You know, I talked to you about people to the point of suicide last week. And I said you need Jesus more than you do the bullet or than the poison or whatever else, right? What if you decided to go through with it and then you stand there before the Lord and said, the Lord said, man, I was showing up 30 seconds after you did that. All you had to do was wait a little bit longer. How would you feel? I was coming. Everything was about to change. Maybe it is. Maybe everything in your life is about to change. But you just got to hold on a little bit longer.
Amen.
That's the message for the night. Bear your petitions unto the Lord. Give them to Him. And don't give up on them. Don't stop praying. Don't feel like you're wearing God out because you ain't wearing Him out. Right?
Right.
Continue to pray. Continue to seek for God to move in the situation. I'm here to tell you that God can do anything. Y'all believe that?
Amen.
Do you really believe that?
Amen.
He had a virgin have a baby.
Amen.
God can do anything. He raised the dead from the grave. God can do anything. God created a tree when there was none. Never before created. And there it is in His mind. He made it and made it to grow and become the beauty that they are. God can do anything. With just a little bit of clay, he made man and breathed into him the breath of life. God can do anything. God sent forth his son, like I said, born of a virgin. And he lived his life, healed, taught, and tried to lead others into the Father. And he was crucified by wicked man, and he died. And he gave him the power to resurrect himself. God can do anything.
Amen.
Right? There's only one thing that God can't do. And I know people say this. They try to be funny about this. But God will not fail at anything that he sets out to do. You understand that? No matter what obstacle is thrown in front of him, when he sets out to do it, it is impossible for God to fail. You understand that? Do you believe that?
Amen.
Then let's do some claiming of that tonight. Let's bring him our burdens. Let's give him our cares. And let's believe it and receive joy from him in the faith, knowing that he is working, and continue to pray, knowing that he's going to work until we see something done in our lives. Amen? Pray always. I ain't saying you got to stay on your knees 24 hours a day. I'm saying as you walk along, continue praying. God, I know you're going to work in this. I know you're going to. I believe and keep trusting him and keep asking. Now, I'm not saying praying for your wants. I'm talking about for your needs. For your needs. Needs of salvation. Needs of salvation on your loved ones. Needs of healing on your body. Things that restrict you, that stop you. God can make a difference. We've seen him doing things. What he said here with Sonia, I don't think the things would be going as good as they were if it hadn't been for prayer for Sonia.
Amen.
With Joe, with this cancer, the great news that nobody was they were looking for, but I'm saying nobody expected it that quick. God showed out.
Yeah, he did.
And he will again. If we just trust him. We believe. Amen. Let us pray. Lord, we're coming before you as humble as we know how.
Thank you, Jesus.
So thankful for who you are, God, and for what you've done and what you're going to do.
Promises,
Lord, we're just asking you to touch us, to forgive us. Lord, and once again, to look beyond our faults and see our needs. God, we're bringing our burdens unto you because we know that you alone and do something about it. We ask that you touch Adriana and the kids there so that, and heal them, and the others that we've been asked to pray for. Continue to touch Lisa and others. Leon and Liz and others. Lord and Judy and others. God, and we just give you the praise because we know that you are more than able to do these things. Lord, and there's more situations than just the touch of the body that needs to be done. There's the touch of the heart. There's the touch of the mind. There's the touch of the spirit that needs to be done, Lord. And you know every situation, and we're going to keep on asking you to touch and guide, Lord, until we see, Lord, what needs to be done according to your direction. We trust you, God, and we give you the praise, honor, and the glory.
Thank you, Jesus.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
I'm going to do an altar call because I just think we should. And I'm going to ask everybody to stand. And like I said, there's not any topic on this altar call. It's just everybody come and has a prayer. Something in your life, you know, we can all use a chance to get closer to God. Come on. Right? Y'all believe that?
Amen.
I think we ought to take every opportunity to give him the praise and honor and glory. Amen.
Father in heaven, we thank you, God, for being down tonight. We thank you for taking your blood. Jesus, we thank you, Lord, for being in a great position to serve.
In the harvest field now ripe, there's a work for all to do. Hark, the voice of God is calling. To the harvest calling you. Little is much when God is here. Labor not for wealth in vain. There's a crown and you can win it if you go. seems so small, and who knows, it is great. If God is in it, and he'll not forget his home, little is much when God is in it. Labor not, who will complain? There's a crown, and you can win it if you go in Jesus' name. When the conflict here is ending and our race on earth is run, he will say, if we are faithful, welcome home, my child, well done. Live as much when God is in, labor not for welcome fame. There's a crown, and you can win it if you go in Jesus' name. If the trials assail around you, and you feel you're all alone, I say that God is with you, and he never leaves you alone. Little as much when God is in, labor not for wealth or fame. There's a crown, and you can win it if you go in Jesus' name. When we enter heaven's portals and our Savior's face we see, cares of life will be forgotten. We'll be happy, glad, and free. Little is much when God is in. Labor not for wealth or fame. There's a crown, and you can win it if you go in Jesus' name. Yes, little is much when God is in. Labor not for wealth or fame. There's a crown, and you can win it if you go in Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen. Y'all believe that?
Yes, amen.
That little is much.
Bless the
when
Lord.
God is in it.
Amen.
And we need not be laboring for wealth or fame.
Brother Joseph.
Yes, ma'am.
I feel led to stand in for Harold and Greg's family.
Okay. All right. Kenneth, you want to come up? Daddy, of course. He's the one. Please.
I'm going to say we're right over here. Amen. So much to pray about.
Our Father, O Lord, as we come to you tonight, there's a great need this evening, Lord. God, we've seen you work in so many cases, in so many ways.
Lord,
your work, Father, it's not always in the big things, but in the little things. But, oh God, you've just been so good to us.
Lord,
just look up and give you praise and glory and thank you. And God, we just bring this to you, God, right to the very foot of the cross. We just trust you, God. You're the great physician, God. All things is in thy hand and in thy power. God, we thank you for Sarah coming.
Lord, I pray that you would touch the
God, we just thank you, God, for an opportunity of
God, we just give you praise.
An opportunity to call on your name and believe, God. And realize, God, that all things can be done according to thy divine will. God bless you, Jesus.
We love you.
Thank you for all you're going to do tonight, God, and all you've done already, in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 Anything else?
Bless the Lord.
I'm going to ask you what I always ask you. Can you say that you know that everything is good between you and the Lord this evening?
Amen.
If it's not, it's your fault because you should have brought in your petition. Right?
Amen.
I pray that if you didn't bring any petition that you can't go to sleep until you do. That your sleep's lost, that you get so burdened down that you toss and turn until you cry out and pray and say, God, take this. Get the devil out of my mind. Bad thoughts, bad words coming into your heart and your mind and you everything. Say, Jesus Christ, I need you to wash it in your blood. Just soak it in your blood. I give it unto you. You say, that's a crazy thing to say. Is it?
bring in your petition and try it and see what happens.
Amen.
To our Facebook audience, we want to say goodbye. Lord willing, we'll see you Sunday morning at 7 o'clock. Remember, like Daddy said, our church service will start at 10:30 on Sunday.